Thanks so much for having me here tonight. I'm really excited to be here and share what I know with you. We have a pretty intense and long presentation that has a lot of exciting information. So I hope you guys are excited and ready to consume all this. Like you guys just said, my name is Ayca Cakmakli. I'm a design researcher at Smart Design. While studying industrial design at Pratt and working on design projects, I realized that part of the design process I was most interested and I had a knack for was design research. And design research is really the process that focuses more on understanding people, empathizing with people's experiences, and also figuring out what the right problem is to solve. And that's really what led me to working at Smart Design and becoming part of the FemDen, which I'll be getting more into later. So as a design researcher, I work with the Insights and Strategy Group at Smart Design in New York. Smart Design is a multidisciplinary design consultancy that's been around for about 30 years. This is a picture of our entrance in New York. We also have offices in San Francisco and Barcelona. A lot of the work that we do within the Insights and Strategy pod has to do with understanding people and their cultures and really translating these into meaningful design solutions, which of course have to translate into successful business results for our clients. Smart has a history of turning insight and innovation into successful consumer products, brands, experiences, and we've designed a wide range of products within consumer electronics, medical devices, kitchen tools, packaging, and services. And our multidisciplinary approach, which brings product, graphic, and interaction design along with business factors, engineering, and design research really ensures that the solutions that we come up with connect with people in their everyday lives. And all these different components from engineering to business to design are really important and crucial to the success of our projects. We have an international staff about 130 people. And 90% of the products that we come up are successfully launched into market. And on the screen are some of the products that we've developed. And as Cameron and the two, I forgot your guys' name, but as you guys all said, our mission really at Smart is to understand people and design for their everyday lives. So I've broken tonight's presentation into two parts. The first part is about design research. What it means to do design research, its importance in the design process, and helpful techniques to successfully conduct design research. And the second part is about the FemDen. So I'll be going over who the FemDen is, why it's important to have a group of experts dedicated to understanding issues around design and gender, and an overview of some of our insights. But before we get started, it's really important for us to be on the same page and understand what type of design we'll be talking about. Everything that we use every day has been designed, for good or for bad, from the clothes we wear, to the products we use, to the experiences we have online and in different spaces. But today we'll be mainly talking about product design. And people tend to bucket a lot of different things into product design. So I just want to make clear what type of product design we're going to be focusing on tonight. We won't be talking about theoretical product design, like this chair designed by Patrick Juan, nor will we be talking about one-off designs, like this chair designed by Mark Newsom, or even do-it-yourself design, a lot of designs that you guys find on Etsy. Because a lot of do-it-yourself design is either handcrafted or produced in small numbers. And we also won't be focusing on products that just focus on the aesthetic components of design. And while aesthetics is very, very important, it's important that the products work well as well. And the reason why I have Philip Stark's Salif Citrus Juicer is just because it's come a lot and has been debated in terms of the fact that it's really beautiful, but it doesn't really squeeze the juice that well, and it drips all over the place. So what we'll be focusing on today is product design that has considered the needs of people, the possibilities of technology and manufacturing processes, and the requirements for business success. So a lot of what we'll be talking about is really mass-produced products that meet the needs of people. And at Smart, we believe that good design really is about making things work for us that fit our lifestyles. Meaningful design isn't just about making something new and cool. It has to make sense with our lives and fit into it. Smart design was founded on the belief that design is about people and not things. And this has always been our belief, and it's more relevant today than ever. We develop deep empathy for the feelings, thoughts, and experiences of people we're designing for to create successful products and services. And it's about understanding people on a deeper level, their emotions and realities, and this really drives us in what we do. And using this principle, we've designed several different products, such as the HP photo printer, which falls under consumer electronics, the Vicks children's thermometer that allows little kids to understand what's going on and feel more related because the interface is designed so that they could easily see it as they're looking down at the product, and houseware products that make chores easier, even enjoyable, like this Comfort Grip potato peeler for OXO. But today, it's difficult to remain relevant. New markets are emerging, new competitors, new and innovative technologies, and even established businesses are being forced to evolve, or they really suffer consequences because their products or their services and experiences aren't really up to date, and people choose to go with other people. So in order to arrive to successful designs that make a difference and stand out in the competition, we really need to be solving the right problem. And in order to solve the right problem, we need to first answer the question of why before what and how. And this is where design research comes in. Only by asking why can we get to the deeper truths that will connect a product or service to brands and people in a meaningful way. If we were just to come up with an idea and execute on it, it'll most probably fail. Because when the root problems aren't solved, you'll only get momentary innovation that'll last for a couple months, a couple years, and then die off. But when you find out what the root problem or the desire is and design for that, then your design will probably stick around. But aside from understanding why, we need to understand the technical sides of the products and, of course, the business opportunities as well. And we have to be really honest about our vision in terms of what's possible. So when we come up with a design, we're asking, well, is this beautiful and useful, but can we actually build it? And can we build it consistently with quality? And even if we do that, will this fit into our business model? So we have to really be thinking about all these different components. And these complex challenges require strong partnerships. And at Smart, we integrate perspectives and different capabilities to come up with successful designs. The word design really is a word that we use to describe the process and the final product of giving forms to ideas. At Smart, our core team for projects typically include designers, design researchers, engineers, and business managers. The industry is actually seeing more and more of a strong multidisciplinary approach. So these different disciplines are really integral for a successful project, and courses that give business, engineering, and design students an opportunity to work together, like your guys' course does, it's a really effective way for everybody to understand one another, and companies are really looking for people like this. So you guys are in a good place. So engineers are typically with a project and work closely with the entire design team from the beginning to the end and are very involved in the later parts of the design phase. They help see the big picture in terms of understanding and realizing how to construct things and have a wealth of knowledge on manufacturing methodologies and how factories work. They bring concepts to life by building prototypes Things they do include brainstorming, prototyping, creating looks-like models, and building CAD models for manufacturing. And business is obviously a very important part of the equation, because when a company designs a new product, it's essentially designing a new business. The business component of design is crucial, and business leaders help clients create new areas for growth. They help companies identify new means of attracting and connecting with users, and they rethink business models as companies experiment with new categories. And design is really about translating the opportunities and findings into successful products and services. So essentially giving ideas a form and a language. Designers on the team have to be in constant communication with the engineers, the design researchers, and the business managers to make sure that their ideas can actually turn into reality. For successful designs to happen, we also need to start, like I said, by understanding people. The folks who are going to actually be using the product or the experience or the service, and really understanding the landscape the products live in. And that's where design research comes in, and that's what we're going to be focusing on in the next half hour. So it's really important to understand that design research is not marketing research. A lot of people get these two confused, but they're totally different things. Design research is about understanding people's needs and desires, building empathy, and inspiring products and services that don't yet exist. And marketing research is about understanding the reactions to products and experiences that already exist. In my experience, I think it would be fair to say 40% of design is discovering what the problem is, 30% is defining the solution, and 30% is designing the solution. So, design research has a pretty important role in the whole design process. It's really important that we set out to solve the right problem, because if we solve the wrong problem, our product will most likely fail. And to solve the right problem, we need to make sure not to approach the project with any preconceived notions. If it's about video cameras, we need to start from scratch, even though we've probably used, you know, video cameras for the past, you know, 15, 20 years. And being a bit ignorant in the beginning can be really beneficial for the outcome. So with any preconceived notions, we can send ourselves down a wrong path. So let's say hypothetically that Canon came to us and asked us to improve their video camera. Designers have been asked to solve this problem for a very long time, but what typically tends to come out are similar solutions of rethinking the same problems. The buttons, the cables, moving things around, maybe making them smaller, taking one, adding another feature. But most video cameras that come out are pretty much an evolution of the previous one, still having the same problems, but maybe made a bit, you know, easier or slightly better. The issue is that designers are really focusing on the wrong thing. So when we were asked to design a video camera at Smart, we started from scratch and to really try to understand who the user was. So instead of trying to figure out how to design a better video camera, we thought, well, maybe we should start with trying to design a better video recording experience. So our user research taught us that one of the most important things about recording video is capturing the spontaneity of life and just taking something out and being able to record whatever you want, you know, on a whim, right there and there. So it was really important that whatever we designed had a was very intuitive and very easy to use. So the result of the project was the design of the flip, and it really allowed users to instantly capture, edit, and share with family and friends. In a lot of measures, we think that the flip redefined the category in the marketplace by introducing a simple, easy-to-use camera. And this really happened by listening and observing to people. There's a designer, Nassan, and you know, he has a four-year-old boy and is always trying to capture these spontaneous things that his kid does, and you know, he had a regular video camera, and it was really hard for him to capture those moments. And so he had a lot of great things to bring to the project with just his own personal life and personal insights too. So here's a brief overview of our design research process at SMART. Design research is made up of a lot of different components, and we're going to be going through all of these one by one. So first, we have to really understand the category. We have to identify areas of inspiration, identify the appropriate tone, understand the distribution channels, understand how ready the client is for innovation, and really understand people's functional and emotional needs. So when you start a project, it's really important to understand the competitive landscape. One of the first things you want to do when you're given a project is to go out and buy other competitive products and bring them back to your studio and try them out. Understanding what works and what doesn't work about them is really helpful. And really trying to understand what you can improve about them. And in this case, we were designing a cheese grater, so we were really paying close attention to the ergonomics of the different cheese graters, how easy it was to use, different components that the graters came with. And we were really trying to differentiate the qualities and the benefits from one over the other. And it's also important to identify areas of inspiration. So, for instance, if a client comes to you and requests a high-quality TV, in our case, that's what happened, it's really important to understand and define what high-quality means to your users. Because high-quality to your users will mean something different from what high-quality means to your client and to yourself. And the easiest way to understand this is to ask your users to point to some products and materials that they think are high quality and low quality, and really realize and understand what it is about these products that make them that way. So, you know, during an in-home session where you go into somebody's house and to learn more about them, it's great if you can just bring material samples and ask them to talk through some of them. And it's important to identify an appropriate tone. Depending on who the client is and what they want, identifying an appropriate tone can actually be really challenging, but it's important for the later stages of design while you're giving form and to some ideas and selecting materials for the actual product. So you need to figure out what's appropriate both from the client perspective and also from the user perspective. For the client, it has to fit into their brand values and aesthetics, and for the user, it has to fit into their values and into their lifestyle. So in this case, we were looking at how a TV could fit into the home, and we realized that the appropriate tone would be really the middle segment, so modern technology that blends into the home, but where TVs currently are is in the left segment, where modern technology really doesn't fit into the living room or into the home. They fit more into an office setting. And the more of an understanding you have of the entire production process, the more effective you can be. So designing a beautiful packaging is nice, but when you have to think about the fact that it has to be stacked on a shelf, stuffed into shipping crates, shipped all around the world, has to withstand high temperatures and low temperatures, the challenge gets a little more serious and sometimes fun. And it's important to understand how ready your client is for innovation as well, to realize how far you can push a product or an experience. And oftentimes at the beginning of a project, we'll spend a lot of time with our clients to get a better idea of how far they want to go. So as a designer, you need to understand that you can't really design revolutionary products or services if your client is only ready for incremental change. And one of the most challenging parts about design research is understanding people's emotional and functional needs. And I'm going to be giving you guys a couple of different ways that you can go out into the field to understand people better, and hopefully use that in your projects while you're at school and afterwards as well. you know, we need to realize that designing something for yourself can be really fun and easy because you know who you are, you know what you like, you know your own aesthetic values. But really, truly getting into somebody else's shoes can be a challenge. And it's even harder when you're tasked to design something that's just not your cup of tea. So, you know, I might not be into this aesthetic, but if my client is and if the users are, then that's what I have to design. And sometimes that's a harsh reality of design, but it's true. And as designers, we face these challenges every day. There are young people in our office who are completely healthy, who are designing for people with arthritis, and this can sometimes be a challenge. Later on I'll be getting into some other exercises, but we do certain things to try and really get into their shoes and really understand their mind frame and their physical capabilities to design better products. So I'm going to be going over some people-centric research techniques. The first one is the depth of understanding people. It's really important to dig deep if you want to understand people's motivations. In traditional question and answer interviews, most of the story is left out. We refer to the information gathered in these types of interviews as reported behavior. So if I ask you to describe how you cut a potato up, I'm sure it'll be very, very different, and I'll realize how different it is if I actually go to your house and watch you cut a potato, because subconsciously you'll just be leaving things out that you might not even know that you do. So to reveal more of the story, observation is needed. And if you want to get even deeper, then you can do ethnographies, talk to experts, and do a lot of secondary research. And the more real the experience, the better. So if you're designing a measuring cup, it's important to watch people use it. Without observation, we wouldn't have realized how common it was to bend over and squint your eyes to read the volume of a measuring cup. So by observing people use the measuring cup and going to their homes and watching them bake and eat meals with them, we were able to come up with this OXO measuring cup where you can actually see the volume from up high from the countertop, so you actually didn't have to squint and bend over. And if you're designing a product for a specific need, it's really important to step in their shoes and try to experience what they do. One designer at Smart, while working on a syringe for arthritic patients, put his hands in a bowl of ice for about 30 minutes to try and create a similar sensation of pain that they would have felt while injecting a syringe. Quality is more important than quantity. Sometimes you'll go out into the field and interview 20 people for 2 hours doing similar exercises, but sometimes it's actually helpful to spend more time with less people. This way you can really understand their life better and the context in which the product will live in. And as an example of one of the projects we did, we were designing a watch, and we really wanted to understand the context the watch was going to live in. Because, you know, if it's on your wrist, you're going to multiple different places throughout the day. So we actually had about, I think, 5 or 6 people we were following, and with one of the ladies, we ended up waking up at 5 in the morning to go do power yoga with her to see how the watch would, you know, live in that environment. And then we shouted her to work to see how the watch could potentially live in more of a business environment. We had dinner with her family to see how much spaghetti sauce would splash onto the watch perhaps, or, you know. And then we went out for drinks one night with her friends to see how it might look with a nice dress on. And the interview process really becomes about getting people to feel comfortable and talk honestly about their experiences. And as a design researcher, it's really your job to create a comfortable environment. A comfortable environment means that you're going to be getting honest comments. If your participants are stressed out and kind of uncomfortable in a certain situation, they'll probably not give you honest feedback. So at Smart, we've come up with these things called girl chats and guy chats, These are informal gatherings that we have in our library. We've realized that women talk more truthfully and comfortably when it's an all-women group, and men tend to talk more comfortably when they're with all men. So we order some wine and cheese, sometimes put some tunes on, depending on the project, and create a type of living room atmosphere within our office so that, you know, people can feel comfortable, like they're talking to a group of friends, and start gossiping if they want to, and feed off of each other's energy. And that way, you can really get some good, honest feedback. And in this case, we were having a girl chat about sports bras, and you know, none of the girls were embarrassed to talk about anything. It was a pretty fun session. And sometimes a great way to learn new insights and behaviors is by allowing participants to lead. You still want to create a loose framework to start the dialogue and make sure that there's a lot of energy happening and content to be discussed. But while questions are good, too many questions can set boundaries. So allowing participants to lead often takes you to places that you actually wouldn't have even thought of. And we do a lot of shop-alongs, and I'm actually going to be going on shop-alongs all day tomorrow and Friday for this project. And basically, it's a shop-along is when you take a user shopping and try to understand their mind frame in the retail setting. Because talking about a product in a conference room or even in a library is very different than talking about a product at a store, because there's so many things going on, there's so many options to choose from. And consumers tend to notice different things about products from 10 feet away, 3 feet away, and when you have something in hand. So taking people shopping and encouraging them to talk out loud and voice what's going on in their mind is a really helpful way of getting useful information. And sometimes it's helpful to find some creative consumers who might be trendsetters in their own right. Going shopping with them and seeing what they're noticing can be helpful. So having them actually curate a shopping day for you. So having them take you to stores that inspire them can be really helpful for you to get inspired for the project. And going back to that tea set I showed you guys earlier, it's really important to understand your consumer's aesthetic. And sometimes it's really hard to do this as designers. And oftentimes I'll walk through project bays with boards that are full of inspiration images from a very designer's point of view. So as an example, we created a series of concepts for toothpaste packaging. And when we showed them to our users, we were surprised when nobody liked any of our package design. And most of the package designs that we created were ones like the Rembrandt packaging. It was very clean, but our users thought it looked really boring. So in order to get a consumer's perspective, we took designers and users out on a shopping trip together. And we invited the consumers to grab toothpaste packaging that they were interested in. And we quickly realized that it was the design that we had to come up with wasn't about clean lines and looking clean. It was more about how we can illustrate energy within the package. And a lot of people, consumers were more drawn to the package in the middle, the AIM package, and also the Crest packaging. So it's really important to get an understanding of their aesthetic. And also having them build their own prototypes. It's great to come to a session with some prototypes that you've built so far to get feedback. But if you also bring other materials like clay or paper and pens and masking tape and ask them to add or subtract certain things to the prototype, you can actually get a really good understanding of what their priorities are for some of these products and get inspired as well. And there's a lot of jargon in the design industry, so it's really important to speak your consumer's language. At Smart, we found that discussing their relationship with products as though they're human beings can be really helpful. And actually, one woman, for instance, described a mini as, a dapper little English gentleman, the kind of guy you'd want to take you out on a Saturday night, but he might be a little short, so you'd want to wear your flats. He looks something like this. Yeah, it's pretty funny. They kind of look alike, right? Sometimes we have our interviewees write up breakup letters, and I think some of you guys have already done that exercise, which is pretty fun. Or love letters, too. Sometimes we have them write love letters. And this really lets us to understand both the functional and emotional inadequacies and benefits of products and services. So I have a fun video for you guys. I hope you guys enjoy it. This is something that we did at SMART about products.
It was meant to be. We met 2 years ago on February 14th, Valentine's Day, the day of the lovers.
You are what every New York woman seeks, what all too often never finds.
It was love at first sight. I normally don't like to show my utter dependence so quickly, but you truly changed my life.
I just wanted to tell you, our mornings together mean so much to me. I heard about you from friends, and I'm super curious about getting to know you.
I was in so much pain in my last relationship, and I think you knew that.
Yeah, this air of casual, Parisian grace that is so effortless, it makes me feel sophisticated.
I dragged you along wherever I went, and you charmed every single crowd.
Dressed in black with that perfectly placed accent of red, you make for quite the endeavor.
And your skinny red frame has only gotten better with age.
Even though your basket sometimes slides down on your attire, I wouldn't change it for the world. Unlike my past relationships, not once have you ever spontaneously looked down on me.
We moved into the kitchen. We're still going strong on top of the counters, against the cabinets, and even from the floor. OMG. I couldn't get enough. I kept pushing and kept going. On the table in the living room, the walls in the hallway, on my computer.
You kept talking all the things I need to know. And now I stand a little taller and I feel confident when I go there.
You're there when I'm absolutely lost. You're constantly teaching me new things.
You made me see the world and myself more clearly. You told me like it was, what you see is what you get, and I appreciate that honesty. You don't judge me for my shortcomings, instead you embrace them.
I feel so alive and cold, you're so lovely, holding your hand of ours, you elegantly swimming around the potholes, winging your spokes.
With every second I spend with you, I feel different. I see the beauty of all the little things because of you.
You throw a caution to the wind and away we go.
You've made my life so much easier and so much better.
You're good to me, five fingers. You allow me to run free amongst the flowers within the field, and I'm injury-free because of it.
Oh, nurse, 828 top medic SL umbrella, you are my dark knight.
I don't think I'll ever put this one. This is easy. The strictly magic eraser that changed my life, and I love it. You make the impossible possible, and most importantly, you make me a better person.
Do you guys like that? It's pretty fun, right? So maybe you guys should, once you guys have finished that assignment, you guys should do a little montage and send it over to me so I can share it with my colleagues. Yeah? Okay, that sounds good. So it's also really important to create a comfortable environment, like I was saying, but sometimes that comfortable environment might not necessarily be a space. We were working on one project where the topic was very sensitive and no one really wanted to share their ideas or their feelings in front of each other. So we actually had to create a blog and we allowed everybody to create pseudonyms for themselves. So they would go on this blog and write their thoughts and feelings with their own pseudonym. And that was a great way to get information. And sometimes, a valid method might be just to ask your user to get together some of her girlfriends and go out, shopping or to a bar and find out information like that. But it's really important when you're doing all of these, you really have to have your design research or designer's hat on and make sure that you're aware of everything that's going on, and you have your secret recording camera somewhere tucked away in your pocket, and you have your your camera ready to shoot all the interesting things that you've seen. So you're not there to have a beer or a martini. You're there to do research. So remember that. So I also wanted to share a couple of exercises that we use while we do some of these different activities, whether it's a shop along or whether it's an in-home. And one really helpful exercise is understanding the journey. We create a journey map, and sometimes we create these different cards that have to do with the project. In this case, it was about understanding a hospital experience. So we had little cards that represented the medical staff, doctors, nurses. We had an image for the house. We had an image for the hospital. We had a little icon for different research methodologies. And we ask the users to really map out what their journey is, to understand the pain points and to understand what really works well. And that's really helpful. And sometimes what you see the line, but sometimes we put a happy face on the top of the line and a sad face on the bottom of the line and have them map out as they're going along a journey to map out what activities or what part of the process is a good experience and what part of the process is a painful experience. And it's always good to take photos of all these activities that you've done, because they might go flying out of your briefcase. So always, always have a camera handy with you guys. It's important. Also, an exercise that we use a lot is a current versus ideal experience exercise. Before you go into an in-home, let's say, and again, to remind you guys, an in-home is the team goes to somebody's house to do research. You can, cut out some inspirational images that you think would suit the category, and bring a big sheet of paper with you and have your participant map out what their current experience of, let's say, drinking Starbucks coffee is versus their ideal experience of what drinking Starbucks is. And always have these. At SMART, what we do is we have these big boards, and whatever we gather in the field, the first thing we do is we come back into the studio and we post everything on the walls, because it's really important to see everything in front of you and to remind yourself of what you've heard. If you put those away in a folder, you're probably gonna forget about 90% of what you heard the next day. You think you remember them, but you actually don't. So it's really helpful to always have them in front of you and post them up on the wall or post them up on boards. Use post-its to, we use a lot of post-its, put post-its on some of the images to kind of trigger a thought or an idea. And if you have any idea, just write it down. Always write it down, because you think you're gonna remember it the next day, like I said, but you don't. So always have a camera and always have your notepad handy. And creating aspirational mood boards are great. And usually we have our participants do this beforehand, before we meet with them. So they'll actually do this alone at their own house, flip through their own magazines, and try to create an image of what an experience or what a product will make them feel like. And along the same lines, we do material explorations as well, so trying to understand what types of materials they're into, and we'll bring, different types of products, different types of materials, and have them talk through it with us. And keeping a journal. Sometimes your budget, because budget comes into the equation a lot, you're dealing with clients and there's a certain budget you have to stay within, and sometimes you can't go meet with six women and spend a whole day with them, so you have to come up with other creative ways of gathering information. And in those cases, sometimes we have them keep journals, so we make it easy for them. We create a journal template in Photoshop, Illustrator, just even Word document, whatever makes sense, whatever you know. And we sometimes give them a camera if it's necessary, and we ask them to take photos, write things that they've experienced throughout the day, and then at the end they'll hand their journals in. design research can also happen without you being there, and sometimes you'll actually learn a lot of information. In this case, we were designing wooden spoons for children for baking, and we knew that children, you know, don't feel comfortable around strangers. So we thought it would be a good idea to give the prototypes to the family, give them a flip camera, and I forgot to put an illustration here, but also give them a little booklet to jot down ideas, and just go to their home. And we actually got a lot of great insights and learnings from this, because what happened is the parent put the flip on the counter and forgot that it was even there, like after 2 minutes had gone by. And the way they were acting was really natural. We learned a lot, and we learned a lot about how people use the spoons. So once we've gone into the field, collected all this information, seen how people use things or think about things, we need to frame our observations. Design research isn't only about observing and collecting. A good chunk of design research is creating usable information for designers and the rest of the design team, designers, engineers, and for yourself too, because you're still involved in the process. So once you've collected a bunch of information about brands and new trends, consumer needs, and you've really understood where the client hopes to be, you need to sit down and synthesize all this information to what we call design actionable insights. These are insights that can directly translate into formal products or services. So for instance, here's an example of some design actionable insights that we derived from a TV project that we were working on. And these insights are all things designers can use to explore new concepts. This wasn't all of it. This is just like a very small segment of it. But for example, if we look at the sign that says a store stand out, if you look at the first one, it says everything looks the same, which means when this really came out of the observation of the shop, we went shopping with some of the users, and one of the first things that they said was, well, all the TVs look exactly the same. I don't know which one's Samsung, I don't know which one's Sony, and I don't know which one's Panasonic. They all look exactly the same to me. So if you want to stand out in the store, you need to really create something different that'll allow you to stand out. But another insight, design actionable insight that we heard was, I want it to fit into my house, and I don't want it to stand out in the living room. So the designers really had a challenge of trying to stand out at store, but blend in the house. And what isn't design actionable? This page has two examples of what design actionable isn't. These are more examples of what maybe a marketing research study would show. But for instance, you know, 87% of the people prefer the red one. It's great that we know that, but it doesn't really become design actionable until we know why they like the red one and how we can use that information for the future of this product or service or experience. So when we understand the motivations behind consumer actions, we can create groundbreaking products. So knowing that she wants a welcoming home isn't really something we can use for design process because it's far too vague. Welcoming to a CEO who lives in Manhattan can be very different to you know, a rural farmer. So we really need to understand what welcoming means.